going on? Welcome back to the channel. Thanks so much for tuning in. Today I've got a requested book review for you guys. A lot of people have asked me to review this book, Very Hush Hush by John Bannon. This is his new book that he put out last year. I picked it up last summer. I've been road testing it since then. I think it was like around $65. It's about 250 pages long, and you will learn 40 different mental card tricks. It's written in the usual John Bannon fashion, so if you've picked up any of his other recent books, like Mentalissimo or Destination Zero, then you will understand what I mean. And when I say the usual fashion, the effects are designed for maximum reward for minimum effort. And that means that all of these effects are really beginner level. There's no difficult sleight of hand, and the effects are designed so that way you can get the most out of them. And if you're familiar with John Bannon's material, then this should not be a surprise to you. So I'm gonna be going through the book, giving you guys, you know, my feedback on what my favorite effects were. I'll also mention some effects that I didn't like at all. I'll also throw in a couple of demos along the way to give you an idea of what some of these look like. But what I'm not gonna do is I'm not gonna just be reading the table of contents. So if that's what you're looking for, you're on the wrong review channel, because I've actually road tested this material. And that's why it's taken so long for me to put out this review, because it takes time to go through this stuff. So, you know, people that are putting out book reviews every week, they're not really road testing that stuff, because when you're looking at 40 effects, it takes a long time to get through those and to really realize and really figure out what are the effects which are even worth performing. And so I would urge you to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already before, but I'm going to first start out by giving you just a rundown of the book, and then we're going to get into each chapter. So the book is divided up into 5 chapters, and each chapter is really like a theme. So the first chapter is called The Sum of the Parts, and that all has to do with tricks that have to do with math. So we've got tricks in there that have to do with magic squares, tricks that have to do with adding numbers and stuff like that. The second chapter is called Karmaholic, and that chapter has to do with impossible locations. The third chapter is called Ghost in the Machine, and that has to do with predicted thought of cards. So a spectator will think of a card and you've predicted it ahead of time in some way. The fourth chapter is called Thoughtological, and this is more like predicted coincidence type effects. And then the last chapter is called Singularities, and those really were effects that just didn't fit in any of the other chapters. So you'll have effects in there that have to do with Equivoke, effects like there's a Bank Knight effect in there. There's an effect that has to do with, it's like an origami-like effect. So these are all effects that really just didn't fit anywhere else in the book. And that's really the book. It's just those 5 chapters. And as I mentioned, it's about 40 effects. So let's start out with the first chapter. So the first chapter is called The Sum of the Parts. And honestly, I didn't like any of the effects in this chapter, unfortunately. And this may seem strange to you guys, because those of you who know me know that I love math and I love mathematical effects. But the problem was that some of these effects just didn't make sense, or they just seemed very weak to me. One of the first effects in the chapter is called Cloud 9, and this was based on like a Carl Heine effect, where basically what you're doing is that you'll be making a magic square with playing cards. So the spectator is going to be coming up with a random number, and then they're going to be, apparently you're shuffling the deck and you're dealing cards out and you make a magic square out of playing cards, and it obviously it adds up to their number. The problem I have with it is it just seems like it's so much work for just a magic square effect. And so it's not something I would ever use. Personally, I think like the best magic square type effects are the ones that are the simplest, where you have a spectator think of a number, they think of a number that you don't know, and then you just make a magic square which reveals their thought of number. And you don't need playing cards for that. You just need a business card, that's it, or a stack of business cards. That's all you need to perform it. And for those that like that type of effect, I would urge you to check out Ben Blau's book called Asymptotes. And there's an effect that's called Pocket Square there. And that's really the one that I use, because it's so simple to perform. You don't have to remember a sequence of cards or anything complicated like that, which is why I think that John Bannon's effort to try to, you know, improve Karlheinz effect, I just don't think that it's really something practical that you're going to really use, which is why I didn't like it. There's another effect in that chapter that's called sympathetic, and basically it's a coincidence type effect with two packets of cards. And personally, it just feels to me like your grandfather's card trick, so I wouldn't mess with that either. It just seems so basic and the procedure seems just so boring that I would not recommend that to anybody. Lastly, there's another effect in that chapter. I think it was called London Calling, and this was based on Jack London's like perfect prediction type effect, which unfortunately here in this version that John Bannon is trying to give you, again, there's no good motivation for it, and it just doesn't feel like the ends that justify the means. It just doesn't, which is why I think that if you like that kind of effect, you should just check out Jack London's original version. It's not half as difficult as John Bannon claims that it is. And if you do want to do like an add a number type effect, there are various add a number type effects out there that are just so much better because you'll use numbers that mean something to the spectators. So that's why that first chapter is a chapter that personally I would recommend you just skip it. The next chapter in the book is called Karmaholic, and this chapter has to do with impossible locations. Now, it basically builds on the main idea of using Marlowe's automatic placement procedure to automatically place a thought of card, and then you're going to reveal it. That's the main theme of the chapter, and it starts out really simple and then gets a little more complicated as you go along. The first effect that you might like from the chapter is called Talking Sense. And here Bannon took one of his effects from Destination Zero and just kind of improved it a little bit, where the spectator is going to cut off some cards off the deck. They're going to count those cards secretly, and then they're going to take the deck and deal cards face up, and they're going to remember the card that's at their number. Then they're going to combine the deck, and then you're going to prove to them that you could predict where their card is going to end up because you have some loose change, and they're going to deal cards, you know, for the loose change you have in your pocket, and they end up on their card. That's the first effect that I think you guys might like. Personally, I probably wouldn't use it because I don't carry change with me, but the effect that I did use quite a bit was called Predeterminant and Predeterminant 2, and I'm going to show you a quick demo of Predeterminant because this is completely self-working, impromptu. All you need to do is have the Matrix Force card with you, because basically it's Marlowe's automatic placement meets the Matrix Force. So let me show you a quick demo of it. Here's a quick demo of Predeterminant, and this is an impossible location of a thought of card. Essentially, it's impromptu other than you needing to carry the prediction card with you, and you could either have that in your card box or even if you're in your wallet if you want to use the spectator's deck. But this effect is essentially self-working, really completely hands-off, and if you're familiar with the force matrix idea, then this will make perfect sense to you. But you're going to introduce this card and tell the spectator that it's a prediction of sorts, and you're going to put it aside, say we'll get back to it in a few moments. But I want you to make all of the choices, and you can let them start by giving your deck a real shuffle or even taking out their deck because you can use their deck. You're going to ask them to cut off some cards and count them quietly so that way you come up with a random number on your own that no one's going to know of but you. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So in this case, it's 13. And then you're going to have the spectator deal some cards face up on the table and remember the card that is at their position. But you have them count out more than the number they're thinking of. That way, you have no idea what card they're thinking of. 11, 12. So in this case, they'll be thinking of this 10 of clubs. Are put back together, and now you're going to introduce the prediction. So you're going to tell them, look, you're thinking of a card, nobody knows what it is but you, and I told you that this is a prediction, these numbers, but we don't need all of them. So what I want you to do is I want you to choose one of them. So now it's another free choice. In this case, maybe they go with, let's say they go with number 11. So we'll circle that. And as per the matrix force, you have them, either you or them can cross out all the other numbers in the row in the column and have them deal down that many cards. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And then you could tell them, well, we still have some numbers on here, so select another number. So maybe they go with, in this case, maybe they go with the 5. So you could circle the 5. And just like before, you're going to cross out all the other numbers that are in the row in the column and have them deal down that many cards. So now they deal down that many cards. They have to agree that this is really their free choice. Ask them to name or, you know, select another number. Maybe in this case they go with the 14. So we'll get rid of these other numbers that are in the rows and the columns, and you have them deal down that many cards. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. And finally, there's one last number that's on there. So you say, well, we got one more number here, so let's deal down that many cards too. So they deal down those amount. Now they have to agree that they made all of these decisions themselves. Really, they chose the numbers they wanted. They cut off the amount of cards they wanted. You ask them for the first time, what is the card that you're thinking of? They're gonna tell you the 10 of clubs, and you can reiterate, so any way I could have known that's what you're thinking of, they're gonna say no. They could turn over that card and they're gonna see that it is indeed the 10 of clubs. So they have located their thought of card themselves, which is why this is like self-working. And all you need to do is carry the little card with you, which you could just have this in your card box, even under the cellophane if you want to, so that way it doesn't get in the way, or even in your wallet. So that was predeterminant, and the difference between predeterminant 1 and 2, because the next effect in the book is called predeterminant 2, is the handling is just slightly different, because you're going to be having the spectator cut the deck into thirds. They're going to shuffle the top third, they're going to look at the top card, then they're going to take the middle section, dump it on top, give that a couple of cuts, and then finally they're going to take the bottom of the deck, shuffle that, and then drop it on top. So under these conditions, it's going to seem impossible that you could have predicted anything, but again, you're going to take out your matrix force card and you're going to have them again select the different numbers they want to, and amazingly, they're going to find their own card, and that's predeterminant too. And I really like that a lot. The only major difference was that the deck had to have one simple preparation done to it to be able to perform it. So the next effect in the chapter that I want to go over, which was my favorite effect from that chapter, is called Triplicity 2020. Now the reason why this was my favorite effect in the chapter is because it's an effect of telepathy, clairvoyance, and precognition all into one. So if you can imagine Marlowe's automatic placement meets the clock force, that's what this effect is. So the effect can be performed impromptu. The spectator is going to cut off a section of the deck. They're going to count those cards secretly. Then they're going to count some cards face up, and they're going to remember the card that's at their number. Then they're going to reassemble the deck, and you're gonna read their mind. You're gonna be able to tell them what the card was, you're able to tell them where it is, and then just to add to it, you can show them that you had a prediction written ahead of time that mentions the exact card they would choose and the exact position it would be in. And for me, that was my favorite effect in the chapter. I think that you'll like it a lot. It's very easy to perform. You can make the prediction right there on the spot, or you can maybe even have it pre-written out underneath the cellophane of the card box if you want to. I've gotten a lot of good mileage out of it, which is why I think you'll like it a lot. And then the last effect from that chapter I wanted to go over is called Zumbaya. And that is a very simple effect that you can perform over the telephone or over video chat, where you have a spectator shuffle a deck of cards. They deal out 8 cards, they're gonna think of a card, and you're basically going to reveal the card that they're merely thinking of, that they selected out of the 8 cards. You don't ever even have to see any of their cards. It can all just be done even over the telephone. But I've had fun with it, especially over video chat. because nowadays sometimes it's hard to find an effect that you can perform virtually for people. And this is one that you don't even need to look at the cards as long as the spectator can follow simple directions. The next chapter is called Ghost in the Machine, and there were four pieces of card magic that I really liked in this chapter. The theme is really simple. A spectator freely thinks of a card, and you prove that you knew what it would be. That's basically the theme of the chapter, and it starts out with an effect called Contrariwise, which has the trade-off that there is kind of an extensive setup to the effect, but because of that, the procedure feels so free to the spectator. The spectator is going to feel that they had a completely free choice of the card that they select. And what you're going to do is you're going to take the deck, you're going to upjug a card, you're going to ask them what's the card that they're thinking of, and you're going to show them that that's the card that they were thinking of. So it's very direct. I got good reactions from it. I think that you guys would like it a lot. The next effect is called Vicinity. There's a lot less setup involved. You could actually do the setup on the fly in front of the spectator. But the trade-off is that there's a little bit more procedure in how they think of the card. In this version, they're going to think of a card. You're going to tell them, wouldn't it be cool if your card was face up in the deck? You're going to spread the deck. They're going to see a joker face up in the middle. That'll get a laugh. And then you'll ask them, well, what's the card you're thinking of? They're going to tell you. And then you're going to show them that the card right next to the joker is their thought of card. The next effect I think you guys would like in that chapter is called Quite Contrary, and it's actually a combination of the first two effects I mentioned. It's a combination of Contrariwise as well as Vicinity, and it takes the best things out of each of those and combines them into another effect. And basically it's the same idea where the spectator is going to be thinking of a playing card and it's going to end up next to the face-up joker. That's basically what the effect is. But it's just different in the procedure and the handling. And I think that some people might like that better than the other two effects I mentioned, which is why I mentioned them here. And then finally, we have my favorite effect from that chapter, which is called Profit Margin, which I got a lot of mileage out of it because it's so simple. A spectator thinks of a card that you don't know what they're thinking of. They write it down on your business card, and then they just stab your business card into the pack right next to their thought of card. You don't know what their thought of card is until you turn it face up, and it's not until then that you show them that it's right next to the card that they merely thought of. So let me show you guys a quick demo of what it looks like. Here's a demo of Profit Margin, and I really like the effect because it uses your business card and a thought of card from the spectator. So you're going to start out by just giving the deck a little shuffle, and you're going to ask the spectator to think of a playing card. Now, the process is extremely simple, and you're not going to know the card that they're thinking of. They're going to write it down on the back of your business card. So they write down the card they're thinking of, and then you're going to tell them to just stab your business card somewhere in the deck, somewhere wherever they want to. So they're going to put that in there in the deck, and all you're going to do is you're going to spread to where that is, and you're going to turn it face up, and you're going to say, oh, look, you thought of, in this case, the King of Hearts, right? So, okay. And then you're going to say to them, what's really interesting is this, is that look where you put it. You put it right above this card, which is also the King of Hearts. How crazy is that? So they literally located their own thought of card. It's very simple. It's very quick, but gets really good reactions. And I think it's because it just feels kind of impossible to the spectator. And in case you're wondering, you can get right into the setup really on the fly if you want to. The next chapter is called Thoughtological. And this was my favorite chapter in the book because I found that the material was the strongest. This is what I got the strongest reactions from people performing it over the past 8 to 9 months. And so I'm going to go over four effects that I think you should definitely take a look at, as well as one effect which I would recommend you stay away from. And that's why you watch this. And so the first effect I'm going to go over is called Double Barreled. Now, this is my favorite effect in the whole book by far. And the reason is because it's so simple, it's so straightforward, and so hard-hitting. The reactions you're going to get are incredible. It's completely impromptu. Any shuffled deck in use, you're going to take out two cards as predictions. The spectator is going to merely think of a card. They're going to freely select a card and they match your predictions. It's a powerhouse. Let me show you a quick demo of what it looks like. Here's a demo of Double Barreled. This is one of my favorite effects from the book because it's completely impromptu and your predictions match a freely thought of card and a freely selected card. It just doesn't get better than that. You could even use a borrowed deck. It makes no difference. You're gonna have the spectator shuffle the deck before you start if you want to. It doesn't make any difference, like I said, but you're gonna tell them that you're going to make a couple of predictions. You say, look, I'm gonna make here a couple of predictions, and you say, here we go, I'm gonna go with these right here. So then you can tell them to name any card they like. So maybe they name, for instance, like the Nine of Diamonds. So you're going to say, okay, Nine of Diamonds, let's look for that here. And you're gonna take it out and you can tell them, where do you want me to put it on top of? Maybe they say here, right? Free choice. You explain to them, now that was a freely thought of card, but let's do a freely selected card. So I'm gonna pull cards off the top of the deck like this. Wherever you're happy, I want you to just say stop and we'll use whatever card you want. So maybe they say stop here. You could say, do you want this card or this card? Maybe they really want this card over here. So then you could say, check this out. If you wanted this card, you would have gotten this Two of Spades, but you didn't want that card. You wanted this card, right? So they'll say yes. And now you're in this position where you could tell a spectator, now you freely thought of this Nine of Diamonds and you freely selected this Six of Hearts. But what's really crazy is this, is that before we started, I put this Nine of Hearts here and I put this Six of Diamonds here. I don't know how you managed to find their mates. And that's it, that's the effect. And you can see how strong it is and how quick it is. It's just a quick effect that packs a really big punch. The next effect you may want to take a look at is called Profit Motive 3. And this is another impromptu effect with a shuffle deck in use. You're going to take a card out as a prediction. The spectator is going to shuffle up the deck, deal, cut. But the card that they end up on matches your prediction. It's the mate of your prediction. Super easy to perform. This is the definition of minimal effort for maximal results. And this type of procedure is the similar type of procedure that I've seen with other people that have done effects like this, like Ben Earl has some effects that are similar to this, where the spectator is going to think back and remember, well, I shuffled the whole deck, I dealt, I cut, how is that possible? It's not going to make sense to it. And John Bannon himself described the effect as the trick that can't be explained, but it actually can be explained. So I think that you definitely should take a look at it because it's so easy to perform, yet it does get really strong reactions from lay people. The next effect I'm going to mention is called Ouija Prediction, and this was John Bannon's way of cleaning up a prediction effect that actually originated with Alexander Elmsley, an effect that he had that was called the Mexican Prediction, but the Alexander Elmsley effect only worked like half of the time. And then Peter Duffy came up with some improvements on it, but then John Bannon took the Peter Duffy effect and altered it so that way it could be completely impromptu. And now we have the Ouija Prediction. Let me show you a quick demo of what it looks like. This is a demo for the Ouija Prediction effect, and it's impromptu from a shuffle deck in use. I've had a lot of fun with it, and let me show you what it looks like. You're gonna tell the spectator that you're going to make a prediction of sorts here. You say, look, I'm gonna take out a couple of cards, and we're gonna go with this one, and actually, yeah, let's go with that one, and let's go with one more. Here we go, we'll go with this one as well. All right, so you've made a couple of predictions, then you tell the spectator to shuffle the cards again and deal out six cards face down, and you tell them that you're going to take your three cards and you will drop them on top of whatever card they want to select out of these six. So it's a free choice. You can tell them whatever card that you like. Maybe like it's this middle card, so you could say, look, you could have selected any of these other cards, right? But you didn't select any of these, although you could have, but you went with this card here. And my first prediction, this predicts that your card's a red card. My second prediction card predicts the suit, which is that it's a diamond. And then the third card predicts the value, which in this case, it's a 10. So should be a 10 of diamonds. How'd you do? You could let them turn over the card. See that it's 10 of diamonds. That's going to leave them in a position where they're not going to have any clue how that's possible. And of course, you end clean because there's nothing to find. You're done. And that's it. It's just a really quick prediction effect. I've had a lot of fun with it, and I think you will too. All right, so you guys took a look at a demo of that, and the last effect I'm gonna mention that I think you should take a look at is called On the Border, and this effect does have a setup involved, but it's really worth it because you're gonna take out two cards as predictions, and then you're gonna let your spectator cut off a section and shuffle it up as much as they want. They're gonna freely select a card from that section, and you're gonna show them that you predicted the value and the suit of the card that they selected. And I think you guys are gonna like it a lot for what it is. Again, it's very easy to perform. John Bannon does go over a very simple move that he went over way back in the day. I think it was from his book, Smoke and Mirrors, that's in the effect, but I think you're gonna like it a lot. The last effect from that chapter that I'm gonna mention that I think you should actually stay away from is called Epically Mental. And personally, I would rename that to like epically weak. And the reason why is because I thought that the move was way too obvious. And I thought that the last reveal was so weak, it didn't justify doing the routine. And so there are other much better mental epic type effects with playing cards. And if you guys go back and watch some of my previous reviews, you will find some of my other recommendations I made to you guys. I've actually shared with a lot of people some different variations that I think are much better, but I would recommend you stay away from that version in this book. So the last chapter of the book is called Singularities, and as I mentioned earlier, these were effects that just didn't fit in any of the other chapters, and the only effect in that chapter I really liked or I thought was useful was there's an effect called Talk the Voke. And basically he's using ideas from Chris Philpott and Red Devil to come up with a pattern line to have the spectator make some choices, and then at the end you can reveal that they were really choosing a playing card. So those people that like to use Equivoke in their card magic may like that, but the other effects in the chapter I found that they were either too procedure heavy or they used way too much Equivoke. One of the effects in that chapter was called Bank Job, and it's like a bank night routine. And if you're going to be using envelopes and money and all this stuff, why mess with playing cards? You don't even need the playing cards to do like a bank night type routine. So it's an effect I would never use it, although somebody might like it. There's another effect that's called like OMG Morigami or something like that. It's like an origami effect that's very procedure heavy. Again, another effect I would never use. And there's another effect in that chapter that's called Rock the Voke, and that uses way too much Equivoke for my taste, where every single decision is an Equivoke. Didn't like that at all. It feels transparent, which is why those are effects I just wouldn't mention to you guys. Anyway, here's my rating of the book. And as you guys can see here, I rate the book highly favorable with a final rating of 4.33. I think it's definitely worth picking up if you enjoy mental card magic, because all of this is beginner level. It's very easy to perform and gets very good reactions. Anyway, that's pretty much everything I wanted to tell you guys about this book. As usual, if you have any questions or comments, just leave me a comment below. Hopefully this has helped you to decide whether or not you want to buy this, but I think it's definitely worth it because you're getting so much material for what you're paying for. And especially nowadays with all of these one trick downloads, this is definitely worth your time and your money. Anyway, thanks so much guys for tuning in. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you on the next review.